पूर्णस्य पूर्णमादाय पूर्णमेवावशिष्यते। ॐ शान्ति शान्ति शान्तिः।
We'll chant from Mantra 1 to Mantra 8 of Ishavasi Upanishad.
Om Ishavasya Midago Sarvam Yatkin Jajagatyam Jagat Tena Tyaktena Bhunji Thama Gridah Kasya Svidhanam कुर्वन्नेवेह कर्माणि जिजीविषे क्षतगो समाः एवं त्वयि नान्यथेतोऽस्ति न कर्म लिप्यते नरे असूर्यानामते लोका अन्धेन तमसा भृताः तागुस्ते प्रेत्याभिगच्छन्ति ये केचात्महनो जनाः अने जदेकं मनसो जवीयो नैनद्देवा आप्नुवन् पूर्वमर्षत् तद्धावतो ज्ञानत्येऽपि तिष्ठत् तस्मिन्नपो मातरिष्वा दधाति तदेजति तन्नैजति तद्दूरे तद्वन्तिके तदन्तरस्य सर्वस्य तदु सर्वस्यास्य बाह्यतः यस्तु सर्वाणि भूतान्यात्मन्येवानुपश्यति सर्वभूतेषु चात्मानं ततो न विजुगुप्सते यस्मिन् सर्वाणि भूतान्यात्मैवाभूद्विजानतः तत्र को मोहः कः शोक एकत्वमनुपश्यतः सपर्यगाच्छुक्रमकायमव्रणमस्नाभिरगो शुद्धमपापविद्धम् कवेर्मनीषी परिभूस्वयं भूयाथा कथ्यतोऽर्थान्व्यदधाच्छाश्वतीभ्यः समाभ्यः।
In the tradition of Sanatana Dharma, we have the habit of worshipping the Supreme in pair of both male and female form. There is never a Shiva without Shakti. There is never Vishnu without Lakshmi. There is never Brahma without Saraswati. The philosophical meaning of this is very interesting, that Shakti or the manifest power is never separate from the unmanifest reality. A Shakti cannot be separated from the Shaktiman or the wielder of power. Sunlight is not different from sun. You cannot separate sunlight from the sun. Sun exists, automatically sunlight exists. Sunlight exists means the base sun is also there, it is understood. That is why in this country, everything that is of powerful form of energy is addressed in feminine nature. Not just, I am talking about symbolism of great Hindu gods and goddesses. Even in Indian languages, particularly Sanskrit, where you have gender for each and every aspect, you will find that all that is very powerful in energy is feminine in nature. Medha, Buddhi, Kshama, all this is feminine in nature. Vedas is said to be Vedamata. And each and every aspect of our rivers, probably I think the exception of, what is a male river?
Brahmaputra.
Brahmaputra is, we can say, is a river which is masculine. Otherwise, Ganga, Yamuna, Saraswati, Kaveri, Narmada, Sindhu, everything is feminine in form. And rivers, you have the force. And Sagar is a male, where it all merges. In essence, after that, there is no separation at all. So you find, throughout the year, we have various festivals celebrating various aspects of our Sanatana Dharma, gods and goddesses. Probably no other festival is this long and dedicated to various forms of Shakti. In Bengal particularly, where the Matha of Shakta is very powerful, is celebrated with much fervor and festivity. But all over India, it is celebrated in different forms. In Gujarat, in North India, is Ramalila on the Vijayadashmi day. In Mysore, in Tamil Nadu, everywhere it is celebrated. And the worship of Shakti in general is prevalent all over India. Right from what it is Balochistan now, which is part of Pakistan in the west, to Kamakya and other places in the east, Bangladesh, to Vaishno Devi, to Kanyakumari, not just Kanyakumari, even in Sri Lanka, it is the Swarupa of Devi only. 51 Shakti Pita is there. Bankim Chandra Chattopadhyaya, who wrote Vande Mataram, he picturized goddess Bharata Mata herself as goddess Durga. He was able to conceptualize like that. That is why there is a controversy that was created that Muslims cannot sing, etc. But it is, and what is interesting is, all those powerful freedom fighters who invoked energy to fight the British, cutting across all caste or religion, cutting across all geographical places in India, invoked Shakti. Paramahamsa, who was very key to revival of Hinduism, was a great Kali Upasaka. And then you find Shivaji Maharaj, you find Subramanya Bharati, anybody, you find Subhash Chandra Bose, various freedom fighters, whoever sought to glorify the Kshatra tendency, they were worshippers of Shakti. Rama is said to have invoked the blessing of Durga before the war with Ravana. Krishna glorifies the Shakti or Maya even before birth. She was the one who was born to Yashoda, and Krishna was born to Devaki. When they were replaced, he glorifies that you do this favor and you will be worshipped all over the place, and he starts the first worship itself. Before invoking, before the war with the Kauravas, after the 13th year of Ajnatvas, Arjuna and others invoke, Yudhishthira invoke Shakti. Before the Ajnatvas also they invoke Shakti. So this Shakti worship is there always. It is a notion of the Abrahamic concept that God is male in nature and female is not worship. But even then, natural worships all over the world had this aspect in them before it was probably wiped out by this. So at any cost, we have to preserve this if we want to maintain the plurality of our Sanatana Dharma. The pairs of main three goddesses are also very interesting. Shiva and Shakti, Vishnu and Lakshmi, Brahma and Saraswati. Brahma is the lord of creation. For creativity, we need knowledge. And therefore, Saraswati is wedded to Lord Brahma. For maintenance in this world, what we need is wealth. So, Goddess Lakshmi is the goddess of wealth who is married to Vishnu. And for any dissolution, you need power or energy, which is Shakti herself. this is not to be understood only at the superficial level of the worldly perspective only. Even from sadhana point of view, from adhyatmic point of view, Navaratri can be divided into three sets of 3 days. In South it is worshipped like that. In Bengal also the order is the same, but now it is Durga Puja, later it is Lakshmi Puja, later it is Saraswati Puja, maybe in Vasant Panchami time it comes. So the order is the same. So what is the significance of this order? First and foremost thing in spiritual sadhana is to root out our negativities. See, unless otherwise the negativities are taken out of our system, it is very rather impractical and impossible to put in any positive qualities or then to gain knowledge. So first and foremost thing is the hard part of removing all the negativities. So Durga worship is there for killing all the negativities within us. 3 days you can say for the negativities at the level of our body, mind and intellect. And then Lakshmi worship is there. Lakshmi is not confined to mere physical wealth as we see, it's the wealth of qualities. Wealth of qualities like forgiveness, like self-control, like various yama, niyama, various disciplines, all these are wealth of qualities. These qualities have to be inculcated next. So, in a mind which is free from any negativities is where these qualities develop. And again, at all the three levels, you can say for 3 days. And then finally, the dawn of knowledge. Saraswati is knowledge. This knowledge is not merely bookish knowledge. It is the ultimate knowledge which is a product of a great sadhana and vairagya. So, Saraswati Puja is the culmination and Vijayadashami represents the victory of or conquest over your own ego. That is why in the Ramlila festival also they burn the effigy of Ravana with his 10 heads. So, Ravana represents the ego there and Rama is able to conquer. Ravana is the symbolism. The Navaratri plus the Vijayadashmi 10 days is not to be taken literally as the time required for self-realization, but it is symbolic of the process. So therefore, to invoke the aggressive goodness in us, Vedanta says it is not merely enough if you are good, you have to be aggressively good. In other words, your good must be manifest and be bold enough to fight against evil and injustice at any point of time. The power of the bad, the power of the dishonest is multiplied or is increasing only because of the passivity or the silence of the good. So then and there it has to be manifest. See, it can be understood that there are some people who are sattvic, who are not expressive and they will be in a soft natured way. Therefore people will take advantage of that situation. Therefore, whoever is supposed to be the protector of the law, they have to invoke this goodness. That is why in the past they said, even Chanakya says, it is the Rajya Dharma which is very important for the maintenance of all other dharmas. If a Brahmin has to maintain his dharma, if a householder has to maintain his dharma, etc., etc., the rule of law and order has to be according to dharma, and who has to maintain it is the government, it is the king. If there is a laxity, then it will percolate at all levels and there will be a chaos. So, but it is not just meant for them. Each and every one of us should invoke the Kshatriya spirit within us, not to be bogged down by bullies. All that we need to do is stand up and face them, not take anything lying down. We get into this passivity or this cowardly behavior when something is directly affecting us. Then we say, why we should get into all this problem? We just mind our own business and go. It will not really solve the problem in the long run. It is better to face the battle and fight it out there. Please remember that even if you are temporarily sort of losing the battle, it is very, very important for you to wage that from your spiritual standpoint and from the standpoint of the society and whoever is around you. So we must not lose this courage to stand up, speak out when it is required, fight out when it is required. The moment you stand up, you will find that those who are actually like the bullies, they just turn away. As I said, their power is coming from our silence only. So the persons, and it is not to compromise with your goodness in any way, because goodness is a character. As I said, first, you know, fighting with our negativities and developing of these positive qualities, it's all very tough. So having done that, you need not compromise on your goodness, because when the pendulum swings from bad towards good, we tend to be passive because we get into this knowledge and we get into finding out our own negativities. So why should we bother about outside? All this will be there. But parallelly, have that courage and conviction to fight where it is required. And that is why it's a very interesting observation. You can, I mean, correct me if I'm wrong by doing research. You find that, as I mentioned, there are various freedom fighters who fought for India, and many of them have invoked this Shakti and the spirit within them. We find in Mahatma Gandhi, who was also inspired by Sanatana Dharma, not any mention of the Shakti worship, as it were. And we know, however strong he was internally, the principle that he advocated probably inculcated a lot of passivity in the minds of the Hindus. And it eventually did not lead to a very desirable consequence, as it were. So it is very important, because Mother, she is of the universe and very compassionate, and she is there to help us at any point of time as we go and surrender to her. But she is ready to take up arms and fight Mahishasura when the situation arises. So that is the beauty of our Sanatana Dharma, that infinite goodness is infinite badness, because goodness and badness is transcended in the infinite. That's all it means. It is not 100 times good or 1000 times good. It's infinite good. So there is no limit to her compassion. Similarly, there is no limit to her fierce nature also. She is infinite. You find in Ramakrishna Paramahamsa's worship that the fierce Kali, how she is like a child to her, or she is like a very small girl to her. We have seen very many great sages who are able to invoke the goddess in this way. She is there, available for us in this form. But if you are going to make wrong moves here or there, she is there to destroy us also. So this Navaratri has to be taken as a war to conquer the negativities within ourselves, as well as take that pratignya that we are ready to fight the evil outside us also. This is, in fact, I think it comes in the pledge of Chinmaya Mission also, that I stand to conquer the negativities within me and without me, outside me also. This is the significance of Durga Puja. Right. Mantra 6 talked about a sadhaka getting over the shoka or the grief. Tato na vijugupsate. He has no abhorrence for any creature. The resistance that is caused by ego is as good as zero. He is able to see everybody in himself and himself in everybody. So that person is a very happy person in the world. And this can be achieved by unconditioned love only. All the religions concur on this, that there is no substitute for this. In fact, there is no other way to realize the self except through the path of identification. Identification means love. Love is when we use the term for the emotion flowing from you to a equal or a lower being. Devotion is the same feeling for a higher being. So we say you are devoted to God, you are devoted to Guru, you love your children, love your dog, all this is love, this is devotion, but same feeling. Identification is when you feel the same way as other. What is love is when you are able to genuinely feel others' pain as your pain, others' sorrow is your sorrow, others' joy is your joy. You are able to feel extremely happy about their happiness. So the thought is out of you and your ego is dissolved. The moment the ego is there, it creates a veil of fence so that people will not be able to mingle with you freely. irrespective of the status of the other person, you will not be able to do it because of the wall that you have created. This is the curse of ego. And as long as ego is there, there cannot be any harmony in any relationships. So this person slowly gets over it by all the sadhana and by invoking the spirit of love. He is now able to see all the self, all the beings in his self and his self in all beings. He has no abhorrence. This, we said, is a state where you have transcended the time, space and causation. You are perceiving divinity as it were. This is the state of Savikalpa Samadhi in technical terms. Yes, sir.
Abhorrence towards whom or what?
No abhorrence towards anything.
But
correct. That's why there's no abhorrence, he's saying. At that stage, there is no question of abhorrence at all. Because the ego is as good as zero. There's no abhorrence. You have to understand that state vis-a-vis the state of people or while he had ego, where there was some resistance to something or the other. That is why in the 12th chapter, when he is talking about the qualities of a bhakta, the first one he says is Adveshta Sarva Bhutanam. So there is no question of dvesha at all, because the strength of the chain is the weakest link. Weakest link is not that you may love the whole world, but that one thing which you hate. It could be, I hate only Muslims, or I hate only cockroach, I hate only a particular animal, or anything for that matter. That one thing that you hate determines your bhakti, not the rest of the thing that you love. So there is no question of any hate at all there. So here there is no question of any abhorrence. So he has crossed over that and he says, so he feels no abhorrence. No abhorrence towards any creature in the world, as it is.
Does it mean that we love or accept?
Yes. That is a positive way of looking at it, because it is not a very neutral state of like being a statue. There is a very pure and unconditional love that is flowing. That is why the second quality of that 35 quality says Maitra. Maitra means friendly. There is a, see, like you can even see a stranger and there will be a causeless smile in you. That is, and there need not be a stranger also, but always there is a friendly attitude. It is not that you are shut off from the world or none is able to approach you or anything like that. You are absolutely open for all. And that is what it comes out as, positive love.
So the word abhorrence is a very strong word. Why not a word like dislike?
No, whatever is the Sanskrit word for that, yes.
Okay. But even from the if it's such a strong word, it has been used, a very strong word has been used.
See, the point is, I don't know the whether it is very strong or light in Sanskrit, but what Vijugupsate means is that there is no question of even a percentage of any dislike or dvesha or abhorrence, whatever you can call it. I don't know the impact of the term in that sense. Now, Mantra 7 is talking about the complete merger that has taken place. To the realized one, all beings have become the very self. What delusion, what grief can be there for the perceiver of oneness? A very subtle indication through the construction of the words in this mantra. In the previous verse, he talked about anupashyati. Here he says, ekatvam anupashyataha. So there, he sees, anupashyati, perceives, seems to indicate that he is still in the realm of experience. Ekatvam anupashyataha is a perceiver of oneness. So it doesn't really, it indicates that he has crossed the experience and that perceiver alone is there. So it's a very, very subtle problem. See, this state is something that is, which is beyond any words. So you cannot really capture it by any expression. But a very beautiful construction here, ekatvam anupashyatha, we'll come back to that. He says, sarvani bhutani atma eva abhut. Sarvani bhutani, all beings, atma eva abhut, have become self alone. All the beings have become self here. Okay. For whom? For vijanataha. Vijanataha means the realized person. the supreme knower. So for those who are new, realization is a state of experiencing God. See, even when we say experiencing God, it is not experience. In experience, there are three things. You are the experiencer, something else is the object which you experience, and there's a transaction between you two that is called as experience. These three things merge into one, and that is called as realization. Realization is something like how you wake up from the dream into waking state. It's a transformation of your personality. So, Vedanta says, as of now, this world that we are experiencing is like a dream state where you are experiencing various things. When you reach your real personality, that is called as realization. It is waking up to the fourth state. So, that is what is indicated by the word Vijanataha here. The moment you become the self, all beings automatically become the self. There is no distinction there. There is no I experiencing God or divinity anymore. God and I are one and the same. See, in the easy way it is explained by Swami Ramtirtha as, in the first phase, when there is plurality, I am the first person and the universe is the second person. I am experiencing the world. And who is God? God is the third person. Third person who is taking care of us, who is making everything function. So, what is the relation then between you and God? He says, Tasyai Vaham, I am His. I belong to Him. The world belongs to Him. Everybody belongs to Him. Him means the third person. And I worship Him. I am His slave. I am His das, whatever you can say. But He is a third person because the main transaction and I am caught up in the world is between me and the world. And in the state of the previous mantra, the relationship is Tvavasau. I am yours. You and I are only there and I belong to you. So there is a duality. I and God exist. That means what? The world has been merged into that God. So you have transcended the time, space and causation, but you are still in the realm of experience where the ego lingers to experience divinity. So I am yours. And in the final stage, when the merger takes place, Tvamevaham, you and I are one and the same. There is no second entity at all. So, plurality merges into duality and duality merges into unity. That is what this mantra is all about. So, it is all beyond all experiences. This is called as Nirvikalpa Samadhi, a state of samadhi where there is no chance of any thought at all. It is a thoughtless awareness. It's a state of absolute awareness. And here he says, Tatra ko moha ka shoka ekatvam anupashyatah. So that means, when the non-apprehension is there, non-apprehension means not understanding the Brahman as Brahman is there, that state is called as delusion. In common parlance, how we understand delusion is, a person in general, when do we say he is deluded? A delusion is when he doesn't know what he is talking, what he is doing. He is in a completely confused state of mind as delusion. So, we take it from the absolute point of view. If we are asked the question, who are you? You try to answer that question. Any answer will not really satisfy that main question, who are you? You will say, I am Mukherjee. That is your name. I am asking, who are you? I am a manager. Manager is your position, not you. Who are you? Finally, you don't know. You will say, man. Man is your species. Yes, you are not an animal. You are not a plant. Who are you? You try to answer that question. You really do not know who you are. But when we are very confident, this is me. That is called as delusion. Delusion is a state where you are very confident and not aware of your ignorance. That state of absolute confusion is called as delusion. A person who is absolutely drunk, let us say, and he has forgotten who he is, and he is talking and blabbering something very clearly. For him, it is very clear. But for a person who is outside that drunken state, who is a normal person, he will understand what state he is in. So like that, the great rishis who have realized the self, they are watching the whole humanity as though caught up in total delusion. So whoever is not realized in true sense of the word, who you cannot answer that question, who are you? Where did you come from? You can only maximum say, I came from this house or that house. Not here. Where did you come from into this world? From my mother's womb. Before that, where were you? Oh, I don't know. Yes, we really do not know. After the sojourn in this world, where are you going? I don't know. So the question is, this life of 80, 100 years, what you live in this world, from totality point of view is nothing. It's just like an arrow fluttering in the light for a while, says Matthew Arnold. Life is an arrow shot from darkness, flutters in the light for a while, again goes back to darkness. How big or how dense is the darkness, we do not know. So where we have come from, we do not know. Where we are going, we do not know. Who is my father's father's first father, I do not know. None of these things I know, but I am very happily saying I am very fine. You know, I have various plans in this world. I have to do this, I have to do that, so much. So that is what is the true delusion. In the previous mantra, when he has crossed the plurality and entered duality, there is no grief for him, shoka for him. He is in a state of perfect peace and bliss, perfect harmony with the world, etc. But still the moha is lingering. So here in this mantra he says, tatra ko moha ka shoka. Where is the delusion? Where is the grief? So he has crossed the delusion. He has obviously crossed the grief also. So misapprehension is transcended. Non-apprehension is also transcended. There is only one now. Remember, in the snake and rope example, when the snake is there and you have not understood this, when the rope is there and you have not understood the rope as a rope, there is ignorance of rope. Once the ignorance of rope is there, then it can produce a snake, it can produce anything. A boy can see a snake there, etc. Now, by deep sadhana, you are closing your eyes and thinking that it is only a rope, it is only a rope, etc. So the snake is out of your mind. When the snake is out of your mind, there is no question of any fear now. There is no question of any other emotions that are there. But that is slightly different from you actually seeing the rope. Now your thought is full of rope, but you have not actually seen the rope. When the light is there and you see the rope, there is no question of any delusion at all. From that state of thought of rope, if there is a chance, I am saying theoretically, we can say you can drop back and something else you can imagine. It can be that snake is not there, something else, crack on the earth, you can project that. So, as long as the thought is there, there is a chance of always getting back into our misapprehensions. Of course, as I am saying, this is theoretical. A person who has reached that state is not going to fall, he is only going to go further. But Vedanta says that don't relax, you have to go further. When you say don't relax, there is no more effort there. It is the ultimate surrender that is going to take you further. But you have to end the journey only when this complete realization is there. So he says, where is the question of shoka or moha? Ekatvam anupashyataha. Ekatvam anupashyataha means perceiver of oneness. As I said in mantra 6, he says very clearly anupashyati. Here the word used is ekatvam anupashyataha. There is no duality. The river has merged with the ocean here. So there is no question of any pairs of opposites or anything like that. He alone exists. That sort of experience is there.
In mantra 6, did we say that time, space and causation is
transcended. Yes.
So, time, space and causation is transcended, but the delusion is still there.
Still there, right. So, that means delusion will go only when you are absolutely in the state of realization of self. Time, space and causation is transcended in the sense that what you experience as is divinity is beyond time, space and causation. Time, space and causation is confined to the nama and rupa of the world. You are not experiencing the world anymore. That person's personality is fully saturated with the thought of divinity. So whatever he experiences in whichever way is only divinity. So therefore he has no experience of any plurality, which is the main issue with time, space and causation. That's the difference.
But when you are saying that there is a duality, Duality is plurality.
Duality is not plurality. That's why we make a distinction between duality and plurality here. How can duality and plurality be same in this context? And just a thought for you to think about, this is not connected to the verse or connected in the context also. When we are discussing the theory of creations in various way, this is one way for you to think about as to how the creation came about in theory of perception and other things what we study. Unity has to become duality, then to become plurality. Because here the process is reversed. From plurality, you go to duality to unity. It's just a thought for you to think about. Now, the choice of the words in Mantra 6, 7 and 8 is commented by Swamiji. You can read the commentary. Mantra 6 talks about Yaha. Yaha means he who. Mantra 7 talks about Yasmin. Yasmin means in whom or in which. Both are the same declension in Sanskrit. That means the individuality is lost there. In which means in which the Brahman. So it can be used as a neuter or it can be used as a in whom as a male also. But the slight construction or change of grammar suggests that that who is experiencing individuality in the Mantra 6 has already become Brahman in Mantra 7. Mantra 8 starts with Saha. Saha is again a male, masculine gender is used. He, as a self-realized person, has become Brahman. So, it indicates a living state of a self-realized soul. You can take it that way. So, these are very subtle points of contemplation. But the main theme is this, that in this topic, which from Mantra 4 to 8, which is talking about the goal of evolution, you have to cross over the main aspect of crossing over the delusion by your unconditional love, where you are able to merge everybody into the divinity and then finally cross that by the knowledge of self. Knowledge of self alone gives realization. To the realized one, all beings have become the very self. What delusion, what grief can there be for the perceiver of oneness? We'll chant Mantra 8.
सपर्यदाच्छुक्रमतायम व्रणमस्नाभिरगो शुद्धम पापविद्धम् कवेर्मनीषी परिभूस्वयं भूयाथा कथ्यतोऽर्थान्यदधाच्छाश्वतीभ्यः समाभ्यः सपर्यदाच्छुक्रमतायम व्रणमस्नाभिरगो शुद्धम पापविद्धम् कवेर्मनीषी परिभूस्वयं भूयाथा कथ्यतोऽर्थान्यदधाच्छाश्वतीभ्यः समाभ्यः.
He is all pervading, resplendent, without body, scatheless, without sinews, pure, untainted by sin, seer, omniscient, transcendent, and self-existent. He has allotted the respective duties for eternal years. Very oft-quoted and famous mantra, which comprehensively captures what that state of Brahman is from the point of view of the Supreme Self as we know. That Brahman into whom the person has merged himself, that means from now on there is no river, only ocean is there. The river has lost its individuality. It has gained totality of the ocean. See, what self-realization means is a very good example. That when you look at rivers like Ganga, Yamuna or Narmada or Godavari, each and every river has a particular taste, has a particular color, has a particular quality. All this is the individuality of the river. Once all the river have entered the ocean, you cannot spot what is Ganga or what is Brahmaputra there. It is all gone. The individuality is gone, but instantly, that very moment, they have gained the totality. So that totality state, which is the self-realization, which is the state of Brahman, is described in grandest terms here. Pariyagat. Pariyagat means went in all sides. That means all pervading. All pervading means there is no space which is not pervaded by the self. See, in the relative sense, you understand, wherever you see space is there, right? Space is not confined to this room, space is not confined to Calcutta. Wherever, whatever area you can think of geographically, space is there. Space pervades all the things and beings in the universe. Now, subtler than space is the self, which pervades even the space. Where is one experience where there is no space? In deep sleep, there is no space. When you are in deep sleep state, there is no time, there is no space. But in deep sleep also, consciousness is there. It is there. So it is all pervading. There is no experience, no place, there is nowhere there it has not gone. It is called as all pervading Pariyagat. Shukram. Shukram means resplendent. Resplendent means it illuminates everything. It is very shining. It is called in various languages as light of lights. Very interesting construction. Light of light. Jyoti sham api tat jyoti. Shukram is in parallel of that meaning only. Everything in this world, as we know, gains vitality and light from the sun god, right? But the question is, who gives power to that sun? You can say there's a nuclear fission happening, or fission or fusion, I don't know, fusion. There's a constant burning of hydrogen into helium, and that is what is coming as the sunlight, all that is fine. Who makes that happen? Who gives that power to that hydrogen, helium, etc. to give that? Who is that light power behind that sun? See, we find that, see, it's very interesting. When you are sleeping and you create a universe in the dream, your dream world, there is no sun outside, there is no light outside. It can be even Amavasya night where there is no chance of any light outside. But the dream you are able to see, how are you able to see? Who is giving that light to the dream sun? Can that power be any different which is giving light to this sun? So who is the actual light giver? It is not that sun that gives light. Somebody who is providing the power to the sun also to give light. It is resplendent. That is the light of all lights. It is Shukram. Akayam. Akayam. Kayam means body. Akayam means there is no body. Avranam. Avranam means scathless. Scathless means there is no injury. There is no cut or anything like that. Asnaviram means without any sinews. Sinews means these are that like that muscles, the tendons and ligaments which give strength and join the muscles, bones, etc. So all these three terms, that is Avranam, Asnaviram and Akayam, which are referring to the body aspect, and he says not body, not sinews, not what is this, scathless, etc., refers to that state which is beyond the gross body. So these three words are indicative of the self which is beyond the gross body. Then there is a word used called apapaviddham. Apapaviddham means untainted by sin or agitations. See, in Hinduism, the concept of sin is commonly, we have to understand as that which is the state of mind which is agitated because of some reaction to your action. If you do, so suppose if you have a value for life and you are out of your desire, you kill somebody or you hurt somebody, that is going to affect you. That is, you are going to get agitated by that. That is sin. You have committed sin. So, here he is saying apapa vidham. There is no such agitation in a state of absolute purity. So, here he is beyond the subtle body. So, akayam, avranam and asnaviram is talking about beyond gross body. Apapa Vidham, which is untainted by sin or agitations, indicate that he is beyond the subtle body. And then Shuddham. Shuddham means pure. Pure means there is no impurity of vasanas, which is beyond the causal body. Vasanas means that which creates your thoughts and desires is the vasana. That means it's unmanifest personality. See, you may not have, you have, let us say, interest of cricket. Where is that interest now? It is there within your personality somewhere, hidden. When it will come? After you go home, if there is a match, it will come. You will watch the TV. Or when you go to Eden Gardens, it will come. Because there is an interest in cricket. That will come. Now it is not there. So, outwardly, in deep sleep also, we are very happy and we feel we are completely through all our journey and finished. No, it is not finished. It is there all deep inside. It will all come out later. So, that means there is some form of impurity, but it is in an unmanifest state. But here he says, Shuddham. The state of self-realization is that there is no potential for any manifestation later on also. Once the river has entered the ocean, there is no question of that river coming back. There is no chance. Absolutely all your interest and everything is completely dissolved into that totality of infinity. So it is called as Shuddham. Then he says, Kavihi. Kavi means, literal meaning is poet. Seer. One who sees is a Kavi. Even in understanding the real poets, suppose you say Rabindranath Tagore is a great Kavi, Vishwa Kavi, Wordsworth is a great Kavi, Shakespeare, Kalidasa is a Kavi. You know, Ramtirtha was a great poet. He was not really categorized as a poet, but poetry used to come out of his mouth. How is it possible? When do you really write poetry? Even in some, most of us write poetry during college days, right? When the interest is not in studies, they write poetry actually. When do you write poetry actually? You write poetry when your mind is brimming with certain inspired thoughts. That is why when the same poets are forced to write a song for the movies, it will not come out with that same effect as they would write by themselves. You put a nightingale in a cage and say you have to sing now. That song will be different from when nightingale sings by itself. So, a Kavi is one who is really inspired. Otherwise, seeing a daffodils or a solitary reaper, how could such poetry come from Wordsworth? Somebody else sees, nothing comes out of him. So, who is a poet who is able to penetrate and see something else in that situation? So, he was not just looking at the daffodils just as a flower. By interpretation of Swamiji, we know that daffodils is something which we can equate our spiritual journey itself. That is what has probably inspired Wordsworth to write the poetry. So whether it is Subramanya Bharati, whether it is a great Kalidasa, whether it is any great poet, Ramatirtha, you find that when the mind is absolutely inspired, they produce poetry. And when is the mind inspired? When the mind is saturated with the thought of self. So therefore, Kavihi is somebody who is actually penetrating and seeing. So he is able to see an X-ray vision. He is not satisfied with the external perception. He is something beyond. So he is a real Kavi. That Kavi is indicated here as the self only. So what really creates poetry is not their intellect. It is something beyond the intellect. It is something, the inspiration comes from the soul within, which is the Atma within. Manishi. Manishi means omniscient. Omniscient means he knows everything. See, this knows everything. In later we are going to study Mundaka Upanishad, where he is going to say, yes, Sarvajna, Sarvavit. Sarvajna and Sarvavit are two most commonly used words, meaning the same. And you know that Upanishads are known for their brevity. They will not waste a word unnecessarily in any context. Sarvajna means all-knower, omniscient. Sarvavit means all-knower, omniscient. What is the difference between these two terms? There is a subtle difference. So therefore in Manishi, when taking class for us in the academy, Swamiji said, he knows everything generally and particularly, he said, in a way that you can describe. That Brahman is able to maintain every order in this universe by the general knowledge and control of the cause and effect principle. See, the nature is very powerful. Prakriti is very powerful. Earth is very powerful. When we saw in Mexico slight earthquake and what happened. You know, imagine that happened for few seconds or few minutes maybe, and you know the damage. If the earth were to shake for 5 minutes, and it is going to simultaneously shake everywhere, we will all collapse within few minutes, the entire population will go. But it is kept under control. Tsunami, one tsunami was there, till today the effects are seen. If tsunami were to occur on a daily basis, who will survive? If the sun's temperature is going to increase by few degrees up or go by few degrees down, nobody can survive. Now, all these aspects of nature which are so powerful by themselves, who is able to know the nature of all these things and able to control them as it is? We do not know, but there is somebody who is doing it. Sarvajna. Sarvavit means each and every particular jiva, according to your karma, you will get that fruit, and you will get, who knows, even when you close all the door and do something in your room which you think nobody knows, somebody is seeing all these things. He knows that. Not only he knows you, he knows what your partner is doing, he knows what the neighbor is doing, he knows what a cat is doing, what a worm is doing, what a parrot is doing, each and everything. So specifically, individually, each and everything that he knows is a particular knowledge. Generally, he knows the total picture is a general knowledge. He knows both. He is Manishi. He is omniscient. This is one way of looking at it. Another way is, what? Who is the Sarvajna? Sarvam Nyam. Sarvam Nyam means everything is consciousness. What you see as names and forms, what you see as the pluralistic world, is nothing but consciousness, just as each and every aspect of the dream is your mind only. You were a dreamer in the dream, you had a dream wife, you had a dream child, you had a dream picnic there, and you went to Sundarbans, something you went, all that is created by your mind. So who is the Sundarbans? It is your mind. Who is your wife? It's your mind. Who is your child? It's your mind. Who are you there? Your mind. So each and every aspect of the dream is nothing but you and you alone. Exactly like that. Now we see all my friend, my enemy, my partner, my this, my that. Everything is totally different from me. But it is all one ray of him only. Each and everything is nothing but him. Sarvam Nyam. And Sarvavit, as I said, is each and every aspect of the world, each and every aspect of every individual, he knows. He knows specifically. Now, it should not be understood as, let us ask a question to the self-realized person. Who is the president of Argentina? He knows everything. No, not that. For that, you can go to Google. Google is Sarvavit, you can say. It knows everything. That is not the meaning here. It means that person knows each and every aspect of your thought, word and deed by which you are going to reap the consequences of your own action. It is not possible if there was not somebody who is, because the person who does the action is not the same person who is going to give the fruit of action. If you are doing the action as an individual, and if you are given the power to give the fruit of action, you will give your own fruit. And if each and every person is having that power, then there will be chaos in the world. Nobody will be wanting to be born as a poor. Nobody will be wanting to be born as a blind person. But according to each and everybody's karma, somebody is making sure and everything is in order and everybody is getting their due karma. It has to be only one person supreme who knows everything. He is Sarvavit. He is Sarvajna. So here he says he is Manishi, omniscient. He knows everything individually and collectively. Paribhu. Paribhu means he is transcendental. He is beyond the terrestrial. He is beyond the body, mind and intellect. He is beyond all your perceptions, emotions and actions and thoughts. So that is transcendental reality. Paribhu. Swayambhu. Swayambhu means self-existent. Each and everything in this world exists with the support of the Brahman. So, from where the earth has come, it has come from the water. From where the water has come, it has come from the fire. From where the fire has come, it has come from the air. From where the air has come, it has come from the space. From where the space has come, it has come from the unmanifest reality. From where the reality has come, don't ask that question. That question you can't ask because we are not linking unmanifest reality in the chain of cause and effect. Unmanifest reality exists as it is. It is a causeless cause. It's the primeval cause from which everything has come. It exists on its own. You need a candle or a torchlight to light everything. But you don't need a light to light itself. You don't need a sun to understand the sun. You don't need another sun. To understand something in the dark, you need light. But to understand the light, to see the light, why do you need another light? It is self-effulgent. It is self-existent. It is Swayambhu. Yatha tatyato arthan vyatatat shashvati bhasamabhyaha. It has allotted respective duties for eternal years. So, since this controlling authority is one supreme being, you find that each and everything in the world functions to a perfect coordination. We need to understand with a little broader vision that what we are experiencing here is not a chaos but a cosmos. There are five senses within you. There are five elements outside you. How beautifully they relate with each other. How the sound relates with ear. How the fire or sight relates with your eyes. How the air relates with your skin. How the water relates with your tongue. And the smell relates with your nose, earth. So five elements outside and five senses inside. Who has created this? Can you find out a better creation? Even when scientists and other imagined authors, very nicely they write novels, let us say, can they try and imagine a sixth sense and put it there? When I say sixth sense, I am not talking about intellect. Beyond these five senses which you contact the world, can there be any sixth other sense? It's not possible. Even when they create artificial intelligence like robo or anything, it is only an extension of the human body. When they make a computer, okay, this computer has also the form of like a gross body, subtle body, electricity, all these things are there. There is no better creation that you can make than which is already existing. You can take a leaf out of this and you can create something else. You can see a bird and try to invent an aeroplane. The person who invented an aeroplane has brains. I am not questioning that. But can you try out something which will do something which you have not already seen in nature? It is just not possible. Somebody who has allotted this in the respective places and they are in order. The proportion of the plantation and vegetation to the proportion of the herbivores which feed on the, you see, geographic channel. Deers and impalas and zebras, they are all grazing. How much grass must be there and how much must be growing constantly to feed them? And they are there in some numbers. And the lions and tigers which feed on this is in lesser numbers. It can never be the ulta that there are so much tigers and lions and only very few zebras are there. It will not sustain. There is a particular way in which this is maintained. In a society, how many must be teachers and thinkers and researchers? How many must be doctors and carpenters? How many must be in government, in army, in police? How many must do business? How many must actually do the manual labor? That's a proportion. Only man tries to disturb this proportion, but in reality he cannot fully disturb. Nature knows how to balance itself. But there is an order or a system. We need to follow this order or system. Who has done this? We do not know. He says. And when he has done, he has not done from 2000 BC or something like that. Shashvati ibhya samabhyaha. So the essence of each and everything in this world, the sun has to be like this, the planetary system has to be like this, unless otherwise a big planet like Jupiter is not near in the solar system to absorb all the asteroids and comets, life in the earth would not have been possible. It is kept like that. Jupiter and Saturn has to be like there and Mercury has to be here. It is all a beautiful system. The seed of a banyan tree has to be so small and the pumpkin has to be so large and it has to be in a small plant. It is all again a part of a greater system. that the fish in the ocean has to be like this and the birds has to be like this. It is all a part of a greater system. So who is the essence of all this? Who has allotted all this? Who is the presiding power over all this? He just witnesses all this. He has made this function for Shashvatibhyas Samabhyaha. He is all pervading, resplendent, without body, scatheless, without sinews, pure, untainted by sin, seer, omniscient, transcendent, and self existent. He has allotted the respective duties for eternal years. This concludes the fourth topic, the goal of evolution, which is from mantras 4 to 8. Mantras 9 to 14 is a very beautiful, very subtle, very practical topic, where you are going to see that in three verses there are going to be three somersaults. That is how the mantra is constructed. And per se, you try to read it and come, but it will not make any sense. You just read the translation. It's a very deep, subtle thought that is given. Very useful for our sadhana. We'll conclude with the bhajans here.
Shanti, shanti, shanti.